Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and welcome to CDT HOD ML4. Now that stands for Congregation B'nai Torah, Hebrew Order of David, Mucolipidosis 4 Foundation. Or another way of putting it is another networking event under the auspices of Adrian Grant. Now when Adrian asks you to MC an event, all you have to answer is say when and where. In case there's anybody in the room who doesn't know Adrian, raise your hand. Well, let me tell you, Adrian, when he's not leading the minion here, when he is not working out at the concourse, when he is not doing your taxes, not raising Israel bonds, or working for AIPAC, he's on a special mission at the airport where TSA and Jewish gene screening come together. He stops any stranger and says, "Do you know Ain Kelohenu?" If he gets a positive response, he lures you in, and you're at events like this forever after. So when Adrian asked me a couple of months ago to MC this event, I said, when and where, and that's why we're here tonight. Unbelievable crowd, over 450 tickets sold for this event, and you can't pack that many people in on a Sunday night when the Yankees and Red Sox are playing unless you have star power. And we have star power right here in the front row, Eden Ray Gold, probably the youngest worldwide person ever diagnosed with ML4. She has a great smile. I hope you all get a chance to meet her up close. And of course, our other star is right here. That's Howard Solomon. Now Howard, he's pictured up here, not a matinee idol, not a loquacious guy, not a sex symbol, but he has put more smiles on the faces of more women in Atlanta than any guy I know. And that's because diamonds are a girl's best friend and jewelry is in second place. So if you need diamonds or jewelry, Howard and the Solomon brothers are your go-to guys. So while Howard has put smiles on the faces of women, our mission tonight is to keep the smile on the face of Eden and others who have ML4. Our mission is to help preserve her eyesight. And our mission, with HOD's unique fundraising abilities, is to raise seed money to be the impetus, the catalyst, the miracle grow, if you will, to getting substantial research started that can then attract major funding and grants. That is what HOD does very, very well, and you'll hear more about that from our president, Doug, in just a couple of minutes. So one more thing, not only am I here because Adrian asked me, but it's also great to have Eileen with us here tonight as well. So to get the evening started, let's get some greetings or remarks from our senior rabbi here at Congregation B'nai Torah, Rabbi Joshua Heller.
I was asked to do something very difficult this evening, which is to speak briefly. I want to offer words of welcome from Congregation B'nai Torah on behalf of myself, on behalf of our community, our president, Kenny Sonnenschein. We are proud as a congregation to open our doors to important causes, to issues that are of concern to the larger community. We are grateful to be one of the institutions that hosts a chapter of HOD, and we are very proud to have a hand in the very important work that our brethren and worthy brethren do. I want to also offer my congratulations to Brother Howard Solomon this evening. Also, express my appreciation for the Gold family, who were friends even before all of this happened, but now I spend most of my time following Randy around and sharing some brief words of Torah before he gets to the important stuff. And this evening, we are talking about ML4, a condition which until recently was really not widely known, and we now have the opportunity perhaps to address it both in terms of prevention and in terms of treatments for those who have already been afflicted with it. And I want to share a brief word of Torah with you. This week, our Torah portion is Tazria Metzora, which deals with the spiritual implications of conditions for which we would normally consult a gynecologist or a dermatologist. And this is often a week when rabbis start to think about, well, what can I say about Israel this week? But the lesson of these portions and their very detailed rules for how we deal with these types of conditions or how they were dealt with in biblical times is actually very important because they remind us that the way that we create our families is of interest to the community and has the potential to be holy. And also the way that we treat as a community, as a society, the way we care for those who are ill, those who have ongoing conditions is also very important. Whether we cast them out or whether we make them feel like they have a place in our larger community. And I'd like to suggest that what we're doing this evening is we are learning the positive lessons of those portions, and we are saying that we as a community have an obligation to draw in those who are faced with these kinds of conditions, to seek treatment, to seek ways to help people like Eden lead full and meaningful and rich lives just like each one of us. And my hope is that tonight we draw a step closer to doing that. And on behalf of B'nai Torah, I thank you for giving us the opportunity to be one of the many places in the community where I hope this happens in the coming year. Thank you.
Thank you, Rabbi Hiller. Thank you very much. HOD, the Hebrew Order of David, started in England, I believe, and then migrated somehow to South Africa, and that's where it had its glory years at the turn of the previous century in the early 1900s. And then, of course, has spread its tentacles far and wide, reaching America, Atlanta, Israel, Canada, and many other countries. And in 18 seconds or less, I can tell you how I became a member. It was Sukkot. I was out of town. I wanted to rush back to attend the Sukkah party here at B'nai Torah. I ran from the airport, got here, got into the party. I said, I don't recognize a single face in here. They're awfully polite. They speak funny, and they're eating something I've never seen before, a borevore. And I said, you know what, I gotta write a check to these people. They're very nice. And after that, they invited me to join, and it's been terrific to be part of an organization like this that really does try to repair the world. And to tell you more about the mission of the Hebrew Order of David, specifically Lodge Carmel, here is our president, Doug Stein.
I may be too tall today, so I'm sorry. I'm not used to being so high up off the ground. It's also never good to be the third person in line to speak because everyone else has already said everything you wanted to say. I'm going to try to keep it brief. I'm kind of known for my brevity, those in the lodge. So I assure you I won't be here for too long, and we'll work our way through this evening. I would like to welcome everybody, welcome worthy brethren, ladies, gentlemen. You're here tonight for a very special event, an event that not only will benefit someone in the room who you'll be able to see to really try to cure disease that is a horrible debilitating disease, but also to honor Howard Solomon. I thought I'd take a few moments to tell you a little about who we are, the Hebrew Order of David, what we do, and hopefully that'll help you better understand how we got involved with ML4. I'll explain how we got involved with ML4 before I introduce Randy. I thought it's probably the best time to make that introduction. We are a fraternal organization that was founded all the way back in 1896 in England as the Hebrew Order of the Druids, and moved forward from England, migrated over into South Africa. And in South Africa, one of the core things that Hebrew Order of David did when they were founded is they, during the immigration of Jews to South Africa, they assisted the Jews who came literally off the boats, helped them have jobs, helped them find a place to live, helped them meet their basic essentials of life and to grow from there. When Hebrew Order of David started growing outside of South Africa, they moved over into the United States and now in Israel. We have a lodge in Canada, and we're looking at a few more lodges here in the United States. We consist of only Jewish men. It's a fraternal organization, so unfortunately women are unable to join, but I can tell you that as spending a whole year as a president, I could not do whatever it is I did without my wife and many of the other women who have been supporting us. One of the things that we try very hard to do even today is to assist our members, and we have kind of gone back to our roots this past year, finding ways to help our members. This is our brethren. This has been a difficult year financially in the marketplace. The past couple of years have devastated a lot of people. And truthfully, the brethren of the Hebrew Order of David have not been exempt from that. We've suffered along with everyone else. And we've been trying very hard to help those brethren who've been in need. And we've helped them not only financially, but we've also helped them through giving them services when necessary and making appropriate recommendations for them. We promote goodwill amongst our men, and we do this through a variety of ways. In fact, tonight is a great example of how we do that, where we try to raise money for charities that we deem to be worthy and charities that'll have a significant impact. We work to encourage marriage within the Jewish faith. We try, in fact, one of the requirements of anyone that joins the Hebrew Order of David, while I can't disclose too much, of course, otherwise it wouldn't be a secret organization, it's an organization of secrets, is one of the requirements is that you, if you are married, you must be married to a Jewish woman, or as we occasionally call them, Jewesses. And if you're not married, then you agree that you will marry a Jewish woman. And should any member, chas v'chalila, ever marry someone who is not Jewish, we simply don't allow them in as members, and whenever that is rectified, they're welcome to join at that point in time. We also encourage education about Judaism and what it means, not just religiously, but also socially and culturally. And part of that, and one of the people that have really helped us over the years, has been Howard. Howard is, if you haven't met Howard, it's kind of hard to describe him. He's quiet. He'll speak this evening. I can tell you I moved here 4 years ago from Detroit, and I met Howard several times in Shul, and I think we probably said maybe 5 or 6 words, but they were actually meaningful words, and they're words that I never forgot. And Howard's one of those people that works behind the scenes to help things happen, to make things happen. And truthfully, without Howard, I'm not sure that the Hebrew Order of David would be where it is today, or that we'd be able to accomplish the things that we've accomplished. If I had to choose a single word to describe Howard, I think anyone in the Hebrew Order of David would agree he's a mensch. I mean, he's truly the mensch's mensch. When people think of a mensch, they usually say, go to Salomon Brothers and look at Howard. If you don't buy something, well, stay longer. So on that note, I'd like to introduce Howard, who we are giving an award to this evening, and I'll present you with the award after you speak.
Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, family, friends, committee hosts, and members of the Hebrew Order of David, I'm pleased to share warm greetings from the Grand President of the Hebrew Order of David International, Stan Claff, who resides in Johannesburg, South Africa. I also like to recognize the President of the Governing Lodge of North America, Les Kreitzik, and the Deputy Governing President, Alan Rubenstein. To everyone here this evening, thank you for attending the HOD ML4 Foundation event. This is a very special event for a very special cause, and I would like to share this honor with my late grandfather, Chaim Goodman, of blessed memory, who joined the lodge back in Cape Town, South Africa in the early 1920s. To my HOD family, I'm most grateful for this honor and would like to recognize and acknowledge so many good deeds of charity accomplished by the members of this order. This is a combination of good leadership and determination to make a difference. I would also like to mention some of the members of the Hebrew Order of David for their roles in making tonight a success. Our Vice President Jeff Kalvariski and Adrian Grant for their committee involvement. David Bloom for spearheading the charge, Anthony Nederman for coordinating media coverage, Dennis Jasek for audio and visual, Eric Byrne for his picture-perfect photography, and Alan Schmern for his generosity in sponsoring this evening's liquor and beverages. To the entire HOD ML4 Foundation Committee, headed by Helen Zelek and Rivki Freundlich, this event would not be possible without you all. Your hard work and dedication is most admirable. A special thanks to Lodge Carmel's president, Doug Stein, for his message of good work done by the Hebrew Order of David, and for his encouragement, guidance, and leadership displayed in tilting the scales of kindness and charity in favor of the Hebrew Order of David. It is quite evident that we all present here tonight for a reason. Making a difference is part of our makeup and is a wonderful attribute to have. Speaking of attributes, we're in a period of counting the Omer between Pesach and Shavuot, a time of self-reflection when we all have an opportunity to reflect personally on our lives and work on ways to always improve and make a positive difference. Over the course of 7 weeks, we focus on seven of our attributes, which are loving kindness, discipline, compassion, endurance, humility, bonding, and leadership. Each of these attributes also represents the fabric of the Hebrew Order of David. For example, as espoused by Rabbi Simon Jacobson, leadership, as mentioned, this is a sense of belonging, of knowing you matter and you can make a difference, that you have the ability to be a proficient leader in your own right and to contribute in this world. Loving kindness, this is both giving and receiving. It allows us to reach above and beyond ourselves. Endurance and ambition. This is the combination of endurance and tenacity. Without endurance, any good endeavor has a little chance of success. Bonding. This benefits all parties. It is the ultimate connection which creates a channel between the giver and the receiver. This implies that all of us here tonight are leaders and can make a difference in helping MR4 Foundation achieve their goals. Changing gears for a moment. One of the most important, prominent questions I'm asked frequently in my profession is the price of gold and diamonds going up or down? Over the last 10 years, the price of diamonds have gone up between 5 and 10% per annum, but gold has gone up from under $300 an ounce to now over $1,600 an ounce, a six-fold increase. As a matter of interest, it takes approximately 10 to 40 tons of ore-bearing rock to make 1 ounce of gold. There's also a human element to gold. Tonight in our presence is a very precious and dear child, Eden Gold, daughter of Randy and Caroline Gold, who are the catalyst behind tonight's endeavors. Let Eden be the motivating force for our generosity. By investing in ML4, it will prove to be a very safe and gold medal winning investment. In closing, I'd like to thank my wife Hillary for all her support and encouragement. Please God, may we all be inspired by this HOD ML4 Foundation event and recognize the many blessings and opportunities that surround us each and every day. Thank you.
Howard's a much better speaker than I. It's actually a little bit embarrassing to come after him, but I wanted to present you with an award. And what the award says is, correctly, Hebrew Order of David 2012 tribute, benefiting the Mucolipidosis Type IV Foundation, honoring Howard Solomon. This is in recognition of all the good works you've done and all the things you've done for Hebrew Order of David. I don't think we could be where we are without your support. Before I introduce Randy Gold, I feel the need to thank all the people that helped make this possible. It is impossible for me to list all the people. Obviously, Randy has been a significant part of it. One of our brothers, David Bloom, Vivki and Rabbi Freundlich, and also Helen Zalek have played a key part, but still have many others. And I'm not going to stand here tonight and read for you all the people that helped us. They're listed on the very back of the brochure, and I just want to extend my heartfelt thanks for everything that you've done that let us achieve what we've done. I ask you all to at least applaud for them. So I must confess, a year ago, I was appointed as the president of HOD. I couldn't tell whether I was happy or sad. Truthfully, it's one of those bittersweet moments in life where you become the president and you say, my God, what have I done to myself? And I was trying to decide which charity I thought, because historically it's been the role of the president of HOD to choose the charitable organization. And I was looking around town, looking for all the different charities that I'm familiar with, and they all do great work. And one day I got a call from Alan Smirin, who's one of our worthy brothers, and he said, Doug, I've got a charity I'd like you to consider. And I said, well, why don't we meet? Let's meet over the thing that Jews do best. Let's eat. So we went out for dinner to a restaurant, and he invited Randy Gold to come. And I sat there at dinner, and I had heard from many different charities. I was talking to many different charities. And this was the first charity where I felt that what they were telling me, or what Randy was telling, was not only personal, because it is personal, it involves his daughter, but we could also have a substantial impact today. And not just today, but even into the future, that we have a unique opportunity as people and as an organization to not just help a charity today meet some numbers that they need to meet, or pay overhead, or achieve a particular goal, but this was a chance to actually change the life of not just one person, but many people. And the research that is being done even today for ML4 impacts not just ML4, it impacts other diseases as well. So I was really shocked that, first of all, I never heard of ML4. Randy indicated to me that it was a genetic disease, and I have to confess, I was brought up in upstate New York, and the closest I ever heard of a genetic Jewish disease was Tay-Sachs. Since then, I've learned there's 19 different genetic diseases, Tay-Sachs being one and ML4 is another. And Randy really appealed to my heart, and as a lawyer, that's a liability. So we spent a meal, and I was really enthralled at what he told me. I was truly, almost cried. And again, as a lawyer, we don't cry. It's bad for us. It's like chum in the water. And when we were done, I went home, and then I called Alan. I said, Alan, you know, I think this is a fantastic charity. We've got to do something for these people. We have to find a way to make it happen. And over the course of several months, I've been working with Randy and others to try to make this event happen. And the more I learned about Randy, now I moved here 4 years ago, as I indicated, from Detroit. People ask me why I moved to Atlanta, and I said, I came from Detroit. I have to ask. And Randy has achieved so much since he moved here. You're a transplant from Cleveland, Ohio, if I recall. Is that right? Charleston, South Carolina. I was close. I'm from up north. Yeah. When I moved to Atlanta, my parents said, where exactly is Atlanta? Is that a new country? Do I need a passport? So it's on the other side of the Hudson, Mom. Just go down. And he's achieved so much. He's well known in the community for his philanthropic work. He's received awards for it. He works with Adrian Grant, and everyone knows Adrian Grant. So without further ado, I'm going to ask Randy to come up and to speak to us tonight. Tell us about ML4.
So Doug joked a little bit about being so high up off the ground. I don't think I feel as high as I've ever been. It is absolutely amazing to see so many of you here tonight. When we first dreamed of this event, we hoped we would have about 250 people. And we had these beautiful table arrangements and centerpieces and decorations. And tonight, over 450 of you have come out to show your support. And for that, I am so grateful. Thank you. So much for the tables and the centerpieces. Whatever. We'll use those another time. You know, it takes so much to put an event like this together. And you've already heard a lot of thank yous, but you have to sit through a few more. I'm sorry for that. I want to start by thanking our dear, dear friends, David Bloom, Rivki and Cheskel Freundlich, and Helen and David Zalek, who really made this event a reality. You should know that Rivki helped plan tonight's event while at the same time planning her daughter's bat mitzvah that was this morning, and her daughter Racheli as her bat mitzvah project raised over $11,000 for ML4 research. Is that incredible? It's just amazing. It really is amazing. I also want to thank Joni Shubin and Lynn Epstein, who were in charge of facility and catering and logistics, all of which changed by the minute as more and more of you RSVP'd. Their job was incredibly difficult, so I thank you both for that. I want to also, of course, thank the brothers of the Hebrew Order of David, my dear friend Adrian Grant, whose idea it really was, along with Alan Smirin, for this event, and President Doug Stein, and of course our wonderful honoree, Howard Solomon. The men of HOD, I thank you so very, very much. We also have some very special guests here tonight, and I just have to mention, they are really Eden's best friends, her therapists, who mean so much to our family. Catherine Shuey is here, Lynn Hodges is here, and also Danielle Dooley. Thank you all for coming, I appreciate it. And of course, I have to mention my parents and my mother-in-law who are here, and my brother who for my entire life has been right by my side, and especially over the last three difficult years, and who was so responsible for helping pull tonight together. Thank you guys very, very much. We're also very lucky to have Paul Tannenholtz and his wife Susan from Baltimore, the president of the ML4 Foundation. Thank you guys for being here. And finally, of course, my beautiful wife, the rock of our family, Caroline, and my three beautiful kids, Natanel, Eden, and little baby Shai, who many of you met for the first time tonight. She's 2 months old, so. She's the really small one. Not long after Eden was born, we realized she wasn't meeting her milestones. She wasn't rolling over. She wasn't sitting up. Her eyes were crossed. And our pediatrician said, don't worry, she'll be fine. She's just gonna progress at her own rate. Kids do that. She'll turn out okay. Well, she wasn't turning out okay. We did two surgeries to try and correct her crossed eyes. We started physical therapy with Eden when she was 9 months old. Still, she didn't reach her milestones. And finally, at 15 months, we took her to see a neurologist. After a brain scan, the neurologist called us at home that night at 9:30, and I'll never forget what he said. He said, I don't know what it is, but whatever it is really bad. And you guys need to be prepared for the worst. We didn't know what to do. There was nothing for us to do. So that night we just stood over Eden's crib and we cried. So the neurologist ran a number of tests. Everything came back normal. So he referred us to a geneticist at Emory University, Dr. Paul Fernhoff of blessed memory. Dr. Fernhoff ran a number of tests and they all came back normal. Then he called us one day and he said, you know, there's one other thing that I want to test Eden for. It's called Mucolipidosis Type 4. Of course, we had never heard of it, but he told us the symptoms over the phone. And before we hung up that day, we knew that was it. So we took Eden back to Dr. Fernhoff's office. He drew more blood. And 2 weeks later, we got the results that we feared. On August 25th, 2009, Eden was diagnosed with mucolipidosis type 4. Now, doctors say that kids with ML4 will likely never walk. They'll never talk. They'll have a maximum mental capacity of about 18 months. They'll go blind by the time they're about 12. And they only live until early adulthood. My baby girl, daddy's little girl. She's not gonna go to first grade or college like other kids. She's not gonna walk down the aisle or have kids of her own. My baby girl. This was not our dream. This is not what we expected when we started building a family. This is not what any parent expects. But this is our reality.
Jewish history is marked by moments when the Jewish people bonded together. They came together to fight an oppressor, to fight a new situation that was detrimental to their well-being.
And ML4 is what they call an orphan disease. And it's an orphan, but it's not an orphan to those whose children have it.
Our wedding day was one of the happiest days of my entire life. I turn around and I see Caroline walking down the aisle. And she looks so beautiful in her wedding dress. And all I can think of at that moment is, here we go, we're starting our life together.
And after we got married, our son was born, probably one of the first happiest days of our lives.
Caroline and Randy have both demonstrated from the moment that their first child was born in Tano that they were incredibly attentive, patient, and nurturing parents.
But then when my granddaughter was born, even though I worship my grandson, I was so excited because I knew that I would be taking her to her ballet classes. I knew I would buy her the nicest tutus.
And the day that she was born was another one of those happiest days of my life. We connected immediately the same way I did with my son. And here she was, my daughter. My beautiful little baby, Eden Ray.
Ah, but it's right here.
I know, it's so fun. Yeah, it's so fun. You want mama?
We knew from early on that something just wasn't 100% right. They said that she had hypotonia, which is low muscle tone, and we thought, oh, maybe that's it. Maybe that's why she's not sitting or rolling. Noticed that she was cross-eyed, and we thought, maybe with the low muscle tone and the fact that she was cross-eyed, maybe that's what was going on.
Was she just a little bit delayed? Was she kind of just marching to her own beat? It took a while to get this diagnosis. And that was a really stressful time. It was a really stressful time.
She was referred to us here at Emory Genetics because of her developmental delays and the knowledge that she had the eye involvement.
He asked us if we were tested for the panel of Ashkenazi diseases, and we said yes. We gave him his test, thinking that certainly couldn't be it, but he called and he said there's one more thing that they want to test for.
I knew about Ashkenazic Jewish genetic diseases, I knew about Tay-Sachs, I knew about the importance of getting tested, but I don't think I ever really knew that there were more diseases at Tay-Sachs than a couple of others.
And there are days that are the worst days of your life. And the person on the other side of the phone said, I'm sorry, but your daughter has mucolipidosis type 4. They say that children with mucolipidosis type 4 will likely never learn to walk. They'll never learn to talk. They have a maximum mental capacity of about 18 months. And they go blind by the time they're about 12 years old.
Even 10 years after the discovery of the MF4 gene, we still don't understand exactly what causes the disease. So there's something in a cell called a lysosome, which is like the garbage disposal of the cell. Byproducts that need to be degraded are sent to the lysosome. The mucolipin-1 gene that is missing in patients that have mucolipidosis type 4 is defective. Without it, these lysosomes don't do their jobs properly. And that's why MF4 is called a lysosomal storage disorder. Neurons, or cells that are in your nervous system or in your brain, are exclusively sensitive to this and in fact die.
These early dying neurons release toxic agents, cytotoxic agents, that will then kill the neighboring cells. And then the neighboring cells will die, the neighboring neurons will die, and release cytotoxic agents and kill their neighboring cells, and you get this proliferation of cell death.
Children with ML4 can live into their 30s and 40s.
They have to take care of a child who stays a child for many, many years.
We still have no treatments for the disease.
Baby.
Baby, so good job. Good talking, Eden Ray.
Oh, you're making her dance. Da 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 da
da da da da da da da da da.
Eden has a different road to go down than other children. Eden has to work extremely hard through therapy to learn what our brains instinctively know. To put one foot in front of the other. And when you see how Eden is working to understand and learn those types of skills that everybody else not only takes for granted, but doesn't even think about, it is such a victory to watch her take a step.
When we found out that we were having twins, that's exact. So, okay, well, my two sets of backpacks, you know, a kid on each side, we'll just, you know, we light on our feet.
And are given tools so that we can help the larger community.
By studying ML4, we might learn about Alzheimer's disease. We might learn about other diseases that affect patients.
This is not a pie in the sky idea. We know this has happened for other conditions, and there's no reason it can't happen for this condition too.
A cure for ML4 is going to be available to us, but everybody has to work on it. I ask you to get involved. I ask you to put your time, your effort, your money into it, and help us find a cure for this terrible disease. We need it now.
In the days since Eden's diagnosis, Caroline and I pray for strength, and we pray for the courage to make our lives a blessing. Tonight, we're asking each of you to have the courage to make your lives a blessing. Each of you has a pledge card that you received coming in tonight. If you've already made a gift to ML4, we thank you, and we hope you'll consider an additional gift. If you're considering a gift that is very generous, of $50 or $100, we hope that you'll do more. If you're considering a gift at a bronze sponsorship level of $1,000, we hope you'll join the many sponsors on the back of the program at the gold or platinum level sponsorship of $5,000 or $10,000. And please, please check the box that says you're willing to make this gift for 2013 and for 2014 as well. Make tonight's gift go that much further towards finding a cure for little kids like Eden, for Lily Tannenholtz, for Scott Reich. Imagine for a second if you were standing up here, God forbid. Imagine if we were talking about your kid, God forbid. What would you want other people to do? I don't want you to feel sorry for me. I don't want you to pity Caroline. And I don't want you to feel sorry for little Eden Ray. But what I do want you to do, what I do want you to do is to have the courage to make your life a blessing by considering a gift that was even more than you thought when you walked in the door tonight. Hosts will be circulating to retrieve your pledge cards. Please, take a minute now. Fill out your pledge card. Make a gift tonight and for 2013 and 14 to help find a cure for little Eden Ray. Welcome to pass your pledge card to the aisle. There are folks with baskets to receive your pledge. As you're filling out your pledge card, I want to thank those people who have already sponsored tonight's event. They're all listed on the back of your program from our bronze, silver, gold, and platinum hosts. Hopefully many of you have joined them tonight. And I also just want to say that I forgot to mention one of the most important people in Eden's life, our dear friend, who's part of our family every single day, Irina Kokolib, who is here with us. She's with us every single day, and we love her dearly. and Eden would not be the same person if it wasn't for her. We're so glad that she's here. Thank you all so very much for everything that you've done already. We have felt your presence for the last 3 years behind us. We felt your support and your love. Many of you from near, many of you even from far, whether it's through phone calls or emails or stopping by the house or even dropping in at my office to offer your support. We thank you for your love and for your care, for being here tonight, for showing your support. Thank you all very, very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you haven't had a chance yet to fill out your pledge cards, there are some more out in the lobby. And as a going home present, we have some very nice chocolates for you to take with you. So make sure you see the chocolates. And again, if you haven't dropped off your pledge card in here in the social hall, you can do so in the lobby. Thank you very, very much for being so attentive and responsive tonight.